I'm Patsy Thompson, and I just love to quilt. You know, people ask me all the time how I dye the fabrics that are the backdrops for many of my applique quilts. Color really matters to me, and it can set the tone or the feeling of a quilt. Colors that bleed or gently bleed into other colors can create gentle but really dynamic flowing backgrounds that make for a very striking quilt. Now, there are all kinds of ways to dye cottons, cotton sateens, rayons, silks, and blended silk fabrics. And if you read much about them, you'll see that people are very specific about what to do. What I'm going to show you is what works for me when I'm dyeing fabrics in Western North Carolina. It's a very hot, humid climate in the summer here, and that's important. What you're going to need is some basic supplies as well as a work area that can handle a dripping kind of a mess situation. Let's get started. Since we'll be dyeing natural plant fibers like cotton, we'll be using Procyon MX dyes. I buy them in a powder form and add water, but know that you can also buy them as liquids that are pre-mixed. Now, you'll also need some soda ash, which is a white powder that we'll mix with water and use to pre-soak our fabrics before dyeing. My two main sources for all my dyeing supplies are Dharma Trading Company and ProChem, and you will be able to see their web addresses listed in the credits at the end of this video. You'll also need a pair of gloves, and I prefer the heavy-duty gloves that are made for kitchen use. They have an extended sleeve to help prevent accidentally dyeing your arm, and they're made of a thicker material. You'll also need some plastic squeeze bottles to hold your reconstituted dyes and some type of a plastic bowl to hold water to rinse the dye off your gloves. You never, ever want to use any of these supplies in your kitchen again. Consider this dye as poisonous and use these supplies only for dyeing. Be aware that these dye powders can be very toxic to your lungs over the long term, so you want to limit your exposure to them and always wear a face mask as you're mixing up dye powders. I wear a dust mask like this one until all the powder has been completely mixed into a liquid dye form. And the last thing you'll need for this particular technique is what I call a large dye platter. This will be a large flat surface on which you're going to lay out your damp fabric and then spread liquid dye onto. So this surface needs to be waterproof. I made my dye platters by purchasing sheets of hardboard, which is what pegboard is made out of before the holes are punched into it, at Lowe's or another home improvement store, and then I covered one side with contact paper. This allows the hardboard to tolerate getting wet and then allows you to keep reusing it again and again. Once your dyeing is done, you can easily clean off a dye platter by wiping it with a damp paper towel and then drying it with another paper towel. One last thing before we get to the dyeing. You're going to need to use either prepared for dyeing fabric, also called PFD fabric, or you can use regular fabric that you have pre-washed to remove any sizing. Now, when I first started doing this, I was taught to always wash my fabric with Synthrapol detergent, but I have found that I can get by with using whatever commercial laundry detergent I've got at home, and that's really what I've used for the last several years. Now, let's get out to the garage where we can start to make a real mess.
I mix up a batch of soda ash and water to pre-soak my pre-washed fabrics. I don't actually measure this out, but it should roughly be a half a cup of soda ash for every 2 gallons of water. You'll be able to reuse this soda ash many times over, so don't throw it out when you're done using it for this batch of fabric. Now, I dunk my fabrics in and make sure they're totally covered, and they'll need to soak for at least 10 minutes, but I've left them in for many days at a time. When I'm ready to dye the fabric, I wring them out well by hand and then run them through the spin cycle of my washing machine. This means that when I go to use them, the fabrics will still be damp. I mix up my dyes using 1 tablespoon of dye for 2 cups of warm tap water. This will give me rich, saturated colors. Now, if you're looking for weaker colors, dilute this ratio. I add just a little water to the powder initially, trying to create more of a sludge than anything else, and I use this to mix the powder in thoroughly. Once that's all been mixed, I add the rest of the water. I pour the liquid dye into plastic squirt bottles and it's ready to be used. We are now ready to go outside and begin dyeing.
And now the fun begins. Spread out your fabric on top of the dye platter. It doesn't need to be completely flat, but lay it out so you'll have easy access to the bulk of it. Now squeeze out a few blotches of dye from one of your squirt bottles, and then do the same with another color of dye. Because the fabric is damp, there will be some spontaneous bleeding of one color into another, but you will also need to help out the process with your gloved hands. That zhuzhing that you see me doing with the fabric is me trying to egg on the color blending process. As you work, you'll keep adding more splotches of color and then blending in that new color as you work on different parts of that fabric piece. Normally, it is very humid here, and that really helps this process because the fabric stays very damp as it's being dyed. Now, on the day that we filmed this footage, it was nearly 90 degrees but very, very low humidity, and this caused the fabric to dry out quickly. Because of that, I did far more zhuzhing on this fabric than I normally do. I point that out because the spontaneous color bleeding that happens creates a very different dye pattern that really adds something wonderful to the design, but there's very little of that happening here. On a humid day, you will see far more spontaneous bleeding and you will do far less manipulation. If your goal is to have color over the entire piece, check all your edges as you work to make sure everything is covered with color. Once you're done, leave the fabric on the platter and allow it to fully dry in the sun. You can move on to the next dye platter, and by the end of the afternoon, you'll have created many more works of art. I wash these first in hot water in my washing machine, and then I wash two more times in cold water. And again, I'm using whatever commercial laundry detergent I have on hand for our normal laundry. Everyone's water is different, and you'll need to experiment to see how many times you need to wash your dyed fabrics to have the water runoff be clear. This is a totally invigorating process, and you will honestly be mystified as you see glorious colors develop right before your eyes. Take the leap into the wonderful world of fabric dyeing. Your quilts will never be quite the same again.